I think we should start anyway, so, because it's too many of us waiting for, it's just a cardinality argument, I'm sorry about this. So, I'm very pleased to introduce Fabrizio, who will give us a tutorial on financial market microstructure. Please, Fabrizio.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you to the organizer, to Eichel. Yes, before starting, I would like to make a kind of disclaimer about what I'm going to present, because first of all, I'm not an expert of games and decision at all. My field of research is finance, is high frequency finance and market microstructure, both on a theoretical and on the empirical side. So try to go back and forth from theory to experiment. So clearly, in a way, my talk is, or my lecture or whatever, is a little bit misplaced, I think, in this workshop. But however, yeah, exactly, this is what I was supposed to say, that Eichel convinced me to give a presentation and to give a tutorial, actually. This is an important remark about these topics, because of course they involve some of the topics that have been discussed here. It's more on the application side, clearly, less mathematically oriented, clearly, in some sense. And we agreed that this should, in a way, given all these points, this should be mostly, at least for the first half, a tutorial on what are, let's say, the standard model in a financial microstructure in terms of asymmetric information models. Because this is not maybe something that, you know, all of you have seen in your curriculum, maybe this is, could be relevant for you know, having an idea about where one can apply some of the idea that you are developing. This would be essentially the first part. So this, the first part would be really a lecture, if you want, about models that will be developed like 30 years ago, and but they are still valid in some sense to give it intuition about market behaves when there is an asymmetric information between two types of agent, as we will see in a moment. In particular, we will be discussing about the two classes of model, the strategic and the sequential and strategic model, essentially Glossen, Milgrom, and Kyle. This will be hopefully just the first half of the presentation. So this is really a lecture, if you want. It's really a tutorial. And the second part, what I'm going to do is going to present something which is related to some work that I've been doing in the last year, challenging a bit some of the view of what some of the prediction that some of this model are doing, and try to find an explanation which matches better with the empirical data. So this would be essentially the main problem. Okay, so just to give some definition about market microstructure and where everything started. Okay, here you can see the definition from the NBIR working group on market microstructure, which is devoted to theoretical, empirical, and experimental research on the economics of security market, including the role of information in the price discovery process, the definition, measurement, control, and determinants of liquidity and transaction cost, and their implication for efficiency, welfare, and regulation of alternative trading mechanisms and market structure. So it's a very broad agenda, if you want, covering a lot of topics which are also covered in other part of economics, and not only of economics, I would say. And essentially, the starting point of market microstructure is essentially a paper by Garman in 1976, where he said that, okay, in the paper was essentially an inventory model. He was saying we depart from the usual approach of theory of exchange by making the assumption of asynchronous, temporally discrete market activity on the part of market agents, okay, and adopting the viewpoint which treats the temporal microstructure, this is where the terms arise, as moment-to-moment aggregate exchange behavior as an important descriptive aspect of such markets. In this, just to give you, okay, the definition in a way, what we are going to focus mostly in this talk is related to asymmetric information models. So in the asymmetric information model, the main problem is the following. So you have an exchange. In this exchange, there is the interaction between different type of agent with different information. So on one side, you have informed traders, which have some information about the fundamental value of the security. And then essentially, you have uninformed intermediaries that provide liquidity. Are the counterpart of the transaction. They can be dealers, market makers, and liquidity providers, and they know that there are informed guys there in the market, and they have to set price in such a way to not be adversely selected by the informed guys. Typically, and this is probably not so it's almost necessary, there has to be also some noise traders, so some people which are totally uninformed, they trade for, I don't know, some other reason, for fun, for liquidity reasons, for because they believe they are informed and so on and so forth. And in some sense, they should be there, as we will see in a moment. So in general, the main assumption is that the payoff of the security has a common value nature. The benefit of owning a security is because you want to resell at the end of the period. Of course, in order to be a trade, there has to be some private component of the value of the asset, because otherwise there is no reason for trading. And so this is the private component, of course, is the information that the informed guys has. There are, of course, also public information present in the market that typically consists in a common knowledge about the probability structure of the game. In particular, there is some information about the unconditional distribution of the security value at the end of the period. And also, so the first maybe is more realistic. The second is a little bit less realistic, if you want, is the distribution of the type of agent. So as you will see in most of the model, the intermediaries should have an intuition about what is the fraction of informed guys which are down there in the market. Okay, so this could be more or less realistic. And then essentially, what is happening in this model is that the intermediaries learn about how many informed, no, not how many, learn the information that informed guys have, they adjust their price, and the price move. So in this way, the information, the private information, is incorporated into the price. So this is the way in which it works. So as I was saying at the beginning, essentially there are two main classes of asymmetric information model in market microstructure. And we will briefly describe both of them. So in the first one, these are called sequential trade models. So in the sequential trade models, essentially, the key point is that each informed or uninformed trader trade only once. So essentially, when he or she trades, it's not necessary that he or she cares about the action of his trades in the how this is going to affect the next trade that he's going to do, because he's not going to do another trade. So essentially, he trade only once, and then he leave the market, and it's not strategic thinking, as you will see, from the point of view of the informed guy. It's only the market maker or the dealer which has this problem, because he knows that informed and uninformed guys will arrive into the market. In the strategic trader models, there is typically a single, okay, at least in the Kyle model that I'm going to describe, the single informed agent can trade at multiple times. So in this case, also the informed trader has to think strategically, has to think that if he trades now in a certain way, this is going to affect the price at which he will go to trade in the near future. So he's going to take into account this fact, okay? And so in this way, the strategic behavior is both from the informed guys and from the market maker, okay? So just to give you an idea about the sequential model, which is the standard model, if you want, the sequential model is the Gloster and Milgrom model. I'm going to give you a brief description in a simplified version, essentially. So essentially, you assume that there is one security with a given payoff V, which can be binary, it can be high or low, okay? And there is a probability delta that is going to be low. Okay, so bad days are good days, essentially. And the value is revealed after the market close. So essentially, in the morning, Mother Nature extracts the value of V, either low or high. And at the end of the day, this will be revealed to the world. Before that, of course, the informed guys receive, let's say, a phone call from the Mother Nature and knows at the beginning of the day if today is a good day or a bad day. And so he decides what to do. And we assume that the traders which arrive in the market and interact only with one dealer or many dealers, let's say, we will see in a moment, can be informed or uninformed, and there is a fraction of informed guys which is denoted by mu, okay? And what the dealer has to do, so the dealer doesn't know, of course, if you know, this agent is informed or uninformed, so what he has to do is to set a bid and the ask price for where to buy or to sell, having the information essentially about delta, V low, V high, and mu, okay? So this is his problem, if you want. Essentially, there are many, many agents, informed and uninformed, which arrive, and essentially at each time step, you draw one of the agents, and with probability mu, you draw one informed guy. If he's informed, then of course he buys if today is a good day, and he sells is today is a bad day. Okay? If, on the other hand, the agent that you pick is uninformed, then it's going to do 50-50, okay? So 50% buy and 50% sell. So no, no probability. And of course, as I was saying, the dealer sets the ask and the bid, essentially what the dealer does is to buy at the ask price and sell at the bid price. And he has to decide at each time step, so he updates his belief, and they have to set the value of A and B. Okay? Of course, the dealer doesn't know if a specific trader is informed or not. Otherwise, that would be too simple in a way. Okay? So essentially, you can represent this by a probability tree, which is the following. So at the beginning of the day, Mother Nature draws if today is a bad day or a good day. If it is a bad day, and this is done once, only once, then at each time step, you draw either an informed or uninformed guy. With probability mu, you draw an informed guy. If this is informed, then of course it will sell. Today is a bad day, and it will buy with probability zero, and we will sell with probability one. If the guy is uninformed, there will be 50-50. Okay? And the same holds here. And with this very simple probability tree, you can compute all the probability that you want, right? You can the probability that today is a bad day, then you pick an uninformed guy, and that this uninformed guy is buying, you know, just by multiplying probabilities over the tree. So very, very simple, and of course you can marginalize and get all the probability. So, what is the decision? So the only strategic guy is the dealer, because clearly the informed guy knows what to do. So the dealer, if the dealer is monopolistic, so there's only one dealer, well, clearly the problem is very simple. You just put the ask price at infinity, the bid price at zero, you make infinite profit on every trade, and this is very happy. Then this of course, shows you that a model like this cannot work unless you introduce some additional, so given that you have only one strategic player, if you want, you need to have another assumption that you have to make in order to avoid this result that this guy plays an arbitrary large spread to the market. And essentially the argument which is typically done in this type of model is that there is a competition between dealers. So this is why I was saying there is not only one dealer, because otherwise the problem would be trivial if you want, but there are many dealers that are competing one with each other, and essentially what they are doing, they are putting bid and ask, and of course the trade will occur at the lower ask or the higher bid, and then essentially the main assumption is that competition between all these dealers will drive the expected profit of the dealer to zero. Okay, so this is, if you want, a lower bound of the spread. So the spread cannot go below the zero profit level, otherwise this will be an unprofitable business. Okay, so the dealer essentially what does is to use Bayes rule to update the belief on V. And essentially, if you assume that the first trade is a buy, okay? So if the first trade is a buy, then the dealer can update his belief on delta. Delta is the probability that today is a bad day, okay? And the way in which he does, he say that, so delta, which is the unconditional probability, is now is going to be delta one, and delta one is the probability that today is a bad day, condition that the first trade is a buy, okay? So you can apply the Bayes rule and you can compute with the probability tree, you can compute what is the delta one buy, right? If the first trade is a sell, it is the same, right? So you essentially do that. If the first trade is a sell, then the probability is given by, so delta one of sell is the probability that today is a bad day, given that the first trade is a sell, okay? And this is something that can be computed easily. So, if the first trade is a buy, okay, at the end of the day, the profit on the first transaction from the dealer will be given by this quantity. So the difference between the ask price at which the dealer has sold minus the fundamental value, which is a stochastic variable and will be revealed at the end of the day. So immediately after the first trade, the expectation on the profit of the dealer, so the expected value of the profit given the buy is given by this value, so the ask is something that he posts, which is can be rewritten in this way. So we have this assumption of competition between dealers that drives the profit to zero, which means that we can set this equal to zero, and essentially we can obtain the value from the ask. So essentially, by reasoning in this way, the dealer, before the first trade occurs, can obtain the value of the ask price that he has to set in order to go zero profit in expectation on the trade that he's going to do. Okay? So this is the way in which the dealer can decide what is the ask price that he has to charge. Similarly, you can do the same reasoning for the bid, of course, it's simply the expected value of V given the sell under the assumption of zero profit, and this is the quantity, and then you can compute the spread. So the spread is the difference between the ask and the bid price, and it's given by this quantity. Okay, maybe this is not totally transparent, so let's make a simplifying assumption that delta is equal to 1/2. So delta equal to 1/2 means that with equal probability today is a bad day or a good day, okay, 50%. Essentially, this expression here reduced to this one, which is very, I think, clear about what it says. I mean, what is the meaning of the spread, if you want. And the spread, so the difference between the ask and the bid, is the product of this quantity, so the difference between V high and V low, and mu, which is the fraction of informed trader. So essentially, the spread in a market is the product of the uncertainty on the fundamental value, if you want. This is just with the volatility, if you want, of the asset in this binary setting will be simply the difference between the two values, times the probability of informed guys. So if the traders, if the dealer believe that there are many informed guys, what he's going to do is going to open the spread more. If you believe that there are not many informed traders and there is competition between dealers, then the guys can reduce the spread as you want. So in a way, the size, given a value of the uncertainty of the fundamental value, let's say the volatility, the spread is a measure of the uncertainty of the fraction of information, of the adverse selection that the dealer is going to incur through its trading. Okay, so and essentially the spread is the way in which the dealer is going to insure himself against adverse selection, trading with informed guy and knowing that there are informed guy. Of course, from a realistic point of view, you may argue, okay, what is mu? Because, you know, how many informed guys are today in the market? Okay, who knows? I mean, of course, this is going to be very difficult. Nevertheless, you know, the dealers, but also non-institutional market maker, what have to do is to place bid and ask, even in an electronic market, in a way that not lead them to lose money because they are adversely selected. So they always have this problem of competition and adverse selection. Okay, and essentially, this is one of the most important components of spread, you know, adverse selection. Okay, so from the point of view of money transfer, essentially, you can make a very simple calculation that in this simplified setting, let's say, which shows that who is losing money in this game. So we know, okay, I can do the math, but you can guess what is going to happen, that essentially what the dealer is doing zero profit. This is what we impose competition. So essentially what is going to happen is that you can, if you compute the profit and loss, what you get essentially is that the informed guy makes money because exploit the information. The uninformed, the noise traders lose money because they are noise guy, and the dealers break even. So essentially this is the way in which the dealer act as a way of transferring, if you want, wealth from the uninformed, for the noise guy, to the informed guy. Okay, so this is the main point. I mean, so of course this is I'm simply show that this is what is happening at the first trade. You can now consider what's happening after. Okay, now the first trade arrives, can be a buy, can be a sell. Then at a certain point, I'm asking what is going to happen next, right? And okay, what's happening next? You can continue this updating of the belief about the value of delta, or the probability that today is a bad day, in a recursive way, and then you have a dynamics in a way of the bid and the ask, and essentially what is happening is that the dealer is learning about the fundamental value by looking at the flow of orders which are arriving. Essentially, this is the main point. And there are a series of properties that can be shown. For example, that the trade price is a martingale, the spread declines over time. Okay, so this value of the spread that I was showing holds, of course, only for the first trade. But, you know, after the first trade, the dealer learns something about if today is a bad day or a good day. So his uncertainty decreases in a way. And so the more trading occurs, the more the spread becomes smaller and smaller because they're under the assumption of competition, because then the dealer is learning more and more about the true value of V, essentially, if today is a bad day or a good day. And in fact, this is something that you also observe in the market. If you go in empirical data, for example, and you look how the spread in financial market behaves during the day, at the beginning of the day, the spread is very big, but then, while the day goes on, the spread becomes narrower and narrower and then stabilized at a certain point, of course, but which means that essentially what the market makers are doing is to learn what the price, the fundamental price, if you want, is today, okay? And any time there is some uncertainty, for example, related to the arrival of some scheduled news, I don't know, interest rate change, something like that, you observe before that an opening of this, empirically.
No, acceso. Would you say they learn, or just it's just that bids, offers and bids accumulated overnight, and therefore they opened the gap? And then...
No, so what is happening in electronic market is the following, is that essentially at the beginning of the day there is an auction phase where any investor, not because they are not designated market maker, they place all the limit orders in the book, and they populate the book in a way. And so they create an initial state for the market. Then the market opens in a way, and there is of course uncertainty about, you know, how the information which occurred during the night has been translated into an update of the belief of the fundamental price, and the spread is very large. And then what you observe is the spread becomes lower and lower. So my interpretation is more in the direction I was saying. And for example, if you know that something is going to happen, you know, the unemployment rate is going to be announced at 4 p.m., then just before 4 p.m. you observe that the spread becomes larger and larger because there is uncertainty about this news arrival. No one knows, okay, in principle, what would be the announcement. So the uncertainty increases and the spread becomes larger and larger. Okay? So, and this is something which is very clearly observed in the market. Okay, so... okay. This essentially is the model, okay? I'm not going to enter too much into these details, so let me skip to the most important part, which is the part about the Kyle model. So now let's consider the case where you have one agent. So the informed guy can trade more than once, essentially, and this also has some strategic behavior to do. So in the Lost and Milgrom model, the informed agent, you know, know what to do. It buys if today is a good day, sell if today is a bad day. So we want to instead to find a framework in which there is also the informed guy, the informed trader is has to reason strategically, and then we found the equilibrium across these two. So this is essentially the most important model probably is the Kyle model. It's an equilibrium model. There are several variants. I'm going to show essentially quickly the single and the multiple period. The continuous time is just very straightforward generalization. And essentially, we have one market maker, so we don't need now to impose competition between markets. We can have only one market maker. But we have now one informed trader. So now, so we avoid the paradox of infinite spread or infinite or distance by having two strategic players. And you have to have noise traders, as usual, otherwise it's difficult to justify trades. Okay, so essentially the model, there is no spread here. Again, the idea is that there is a terminal, there is a liquidation value V, the fundamental value V, and that this is normally distributed with a mean P0 and the variance sigma 0. Okay, and again, the informed trader knows V and has to decide the demand that he wants to enter, how much to buy or how much to sell. So in the previous one, it was one unit, so it was no problem. So here the strategic thinking of the agent is how many shares to trade, okay? We have, of course, noise trader that have an order flow. They place some order to buy or to sell, which is Gaussian with some variance, sigma U square and zero mean, so either they buy or they sell. And the market makers observe the total demand, so observe the informed demand and the uninformed demand, but in an aggregate way. So it doesn't know. If I observe that people want to buy a lot, I don't know if they want to buy because there is one informer they want to sell and many uninformed they want to buy, right? I mean, because I only observe the aggregate in a way. And what the market maker has to do is to set the price at which this trade occurs. Okay. So what is the idea of the model, if you want? So the idea of the model is that clearly the informed trader wants to trade as much as possible because he has some information. He knows that he has some disinformation. So he has no restriction about, so he can trade infinite amount, so no banking restriction. So he can trade as much as he wants, and he wants to exploit it. So in principle, he would like to trade, you know, 1 billion, trillion, zillion shares, right? However, the point is that the market maker knows that there is an informed guy, and if the market maker observes a huge demand to buy, is going to protect himself by putting a very high price, right? And then this means that it's not very convenient for the informed guy to place too much, because otherwise he's going to not gain money because the market maker protects himself, okay? And essentially all the model is about a solution of this trade-off. And okay, so the key point is that the solution of the model is the following. So the informed trader conjectured that the market maker use a linear price adjustment rule. So the price is a linear function of the demand. And lambda, if you want, is inversely related to liquidity. The profit of the informed trader in this single period is the difference between the value that he knows and the price times X, which is given by this. If you take the expectation, essentially what you get, the expected profit of the informed guy is this quadratic function of the amount of shares of X, which clearly has a maximum at the vertex of the parabola, right? And the vertex of the parabola is the optimal amount. So given that he knows lambda and mu, this is the optimal amount that he will need to trade. If he trades too much, then the he's going to lose money, okay? Similarly, the market maker has to conjecture what is the demand of the informed guy as a function of V. And again, he conjectures that this is a linear function. So if today is a very good day, he wants to buy a lot. If today is a very bad day, he wants to sell a lot, okay? It's a linear function. And the market maker knows the optimization process of the informed, and essentially, by taking this expression and equating, you have a relationship between the parameter alpha and beta that the market maker conjecture and the parameter lambda and mu that the other guys conjecture, okay? The market maker observes Y, so observe the amount, and sets the price at the efficient value, which is the expected value of V given Y. So given the demand that is observed, this will be the value of the price that you will set. Okay, so essentially the reason why you can solve this problem is that you assume normality, and with some normality, I'm not wanting to enter into the detail, but assuming normality and by using some property of bivariate normal, you can easily solve the model. Let me show you the solution of the model, if you want, which is the equilibrium solution, which is pretty transparent and I think is informative as in this model. So essentially the idea is that P0 is the unconditional value of the price. So P minus P, so you can think this as a beginning of the day price. So P minus P0 is the price impact, is how much the price move because of a demand Y which is arriving. So what the model forecasts, what the model predicts is that the impact is linear in the demand, okay? And the proportionality, which is the inverse of the liquidity, is related to two quantities. One is the uncertainty on the price, okay? And the other one is the, if you want, how big are the noise guy. So this is the variance of the demand of the noise guy. If there are a lot of noise guy, then the price is going to move very little. So essentially, liquidity is higher when there are more uninformed guy. So this is the key point. And the informed agent, this is the optimal amount of shares that you want to trade, which of course is proportional to the mispricing, okay, the V minus the P0. But the most important point, of course, is this quantity here, which is the inverse of this, which tells you that this is, so that when there are many uninformed guy, he can trade more. He can trade more because he can hide his order flow, his flow into the noise guy. If there are not many An informed guy, then, of course, he has to trade a little in order not to inform the market maker about the price. Okay, so this is the trade-off. This also affects, of course, the expected profit of the informed guy in this way. So the same quantity, if you want, right? So informed guy makes money on average when there are more uninformed people. Okay. I want just to go very quickly about the Kyle model, just because this will be related to the second part of the talk. So you can extend, so this is a single period model, so you can go in multi-period, either in discrete or in continuous time. Essentially you have a sequence of auction, one after the other. In each auction, the informed has to decide how much to trade. So he knows at the beginning of the day the fundamental value. At each auction, he has to decide how much to trade. The market maker observes the sum of the two and has to decide the price. And of course, again, they learn through the past price. So it's not important. You will see in the slide, it's just standard, or reading the Kyle paper, which is very, very nice paper, actually. Very clearly written, in a way. Okay, so essentially the main point is that the theorem is that there exists, under the assumption, again, of Gaussianity and so on and so forth, there is a unique linear equilibrium in this multi-period model. And essentially there are some constants, which were here, which are given by this. So essentially delta xn is the quantity which is traded by the informed guy at auction n. Okay, there are big n auctions, right? And then small n is the index. Okay, and the quantity that he has to trade is given by this quantity, so it's related to the mispricing observed at this time. Okay, this is not that important. Again, we obtain that the price impact at each interval is a linear function of the volume. So if you double the number of the demand, you will observe a doubling of the price movement. So delta Pn is the difference of the price between two auctions. The uncertainty from the point of view of the market maker on the fundamental value conditional on the past order flow is declining with time. Okay, this is smaller than one. So this is declining with time. So essentially, as in the Glosten-Milgrom, in this multi-period setting, he learns what is going to happen. So this doesn't go to zero because you have a finite number of auctions. But if you go in continuous time, this goes to zero, of course. I mean, then essentially at the very end, the price converges to the fundamental value. And essentially, okay, the prediction that I'm going to compare with empirical data, if you want now, is that, okay, so the first important point is that what the informed agent wants to do. So you see from here, so the agent in principle could trade everything in the first auction and then zero in all the other auctions, or trade zero, do whatever he wants. At the end, what you can get from this is that the optimal solution, and you understand from the single period why, the optimal solution for the informed guy is to take the order, he wants to trade 1 million shares, and he takes the order, he divides it in pieces, okay, and he slice and dice, order splitting, you can call it as you want, and he trades incrementally through time. Why? Well, because in each period he wants to trade as little as possible in order to hide his order flow into the order flow of the uninformed guy. Right? And this is a slice and dice, and this is justification from slicing and dicing, right? I mean, to hide, avoid the information leakage, let's say the information that he has. The other prediction is linear price impact, which is what we have seen. There is, okay, it's not clear from here, but that the order flow is uncorrelated with time, so there is no time correlation in the order flow. The impact is permanent and fixed in the sense that when this is done, okay, the price stays fixed. I mean, of course, it's not clear what is going to happen after the execution finish. Okay, and the variance of the fundamental value declines with time. Okay, so let's go now to this was really 1985 market microstructure. Let's go and see how the real market works. So let's start with the impact. So impact is how much the price moves when you trade a given amount of shares. So the first thing is, okay, depends what type of impact you want to look at. If you want to look at the impact of individual trades, okay, or trades in a very in a small time interval. So what a huge amount of empirical literature now shows is that the impact, so the expected value of the price change condition on the volume, is in fact a very concave function of the volume. Okay, it's not linear at all. Some authors, including myself, describe this as a power law function with an exponent which is very small. Other authors, like Jean-Philippe Bouchot, fit with a logarithmic function. I don't think this is very relevant, but the key point is really that the impact is not linear. So when you trade twice, you impact the price less than twice. Okay? You can also, this is for individual impact, is something which is very simple. In terms of the Kyle model, what you would like to know is how much I'm going to move the price if I trade with this slice and dice type of algorithm. And this, of course, is more complicated to compute because, I mean, I'm not a trader, so I don't, or if I, even if I'm a trader, I'm a very small trader, so I'm not going to slice and dice that much. There's no need for me, but if I would be a big hedge fund or mutual fund, then I would have this necessity. But I don't have this information in a way. So it's very difficult in a way to measure the impact of this, I call this meta order, which means this large order which are divided and traded incrementally through time. Who can do this? Well, clearly, who has proprietary information? Okay, this is one possibility. And there are some papers published by people in the industry, and I will show one example, that show how the price, how the order flow, the flow impact the price for a meta order, for a large order, not for individual trade. And there is actually this is well known in the industry for many, many years, that in fact the data seems to fit pretty well to what is called the square root impact law, which means that the impact is essentially the square root proportional to the square root of the volume that you want to trade, okay, for large orders. And okay, according to people working in the industry, this is not very related to the way in which you trade. I mean, you can trade in very more or less sophisticated way, but at the end, this is what you get. Okay, this is one example of the literature that I was mentioning. This is from a paper by some people working in a very large hedge fund in France, and essentially they were taking their own large trade, the large execution, and in a log-log scale, essentially they were plotting quantity versus price change. And okay, this is the, let's say, square root law, and this would be the linear Kyle model, if you want. Okay, so clearly, it's not linear. This seems to be pretty clear. I also did some work with more complicated. I didn't have this information. Just to mention, we have access to some data where we know the identity of the trader behind each trade in the financial market. So essentially, what we try to do is to reconstruct statistically, you know, by chaining together many buys made by the same guy to reconstruct statistically one of these large order. For example, this is, I don't know, the inventory of Crédit Agricole trading Santander. Okay, so it clearly was buying, and then selling, then buying again, and so on. And essentially, what you want to do is to find a way of cutting this time series into pieces such that you can interpret each of these as one of these large orders. We developed several methods for doing this based on the Markov model. Okay, that doesn't matter. But at the end, the main conclusion is that, again, we find something which is very close to a square root function, both for the London Stock Exchange and for the Madrid Stock Exchange. These are statistically reconstructed algorithmic execution, if you want. And what we observe, and other people also observe, is that after the end, so this is the price. You start trading here, and then the price goes up, on average, of course. Goes up, you buy, for example, the price goes up until the end, and then the price reverts back to a value which is in between, let's say, the top and the starting point, okay? Which, again, something which is not captured by the Kyle model. So this is the second evidence, if you want, that the Kyle model is not able to capture this feature. The third property is related to the order flow. So remember, in the Kyle model, the order flow is uncorrelated with time. So when I talk about order flow, I'm saying if I call the order flow the signed volume which arrived to the market, okay, I want to see if, you know, more buys are followed by more buys or more buys are followed by more sell or something like that. Okay, so what we did, now many years ago, is to show that, in fact, order flow is very correlated. I will show in a moment. Essentially, what we did, and this has been replicated in many, many markets, and essentially the idea here is that again, it's an empirical evidence that I'm going to show you. If you consider a market order, so an order that trigger a transaction, that start a transaction, and essentially you put a sign plus one if it is a buy and minus one if it is a sell, then you have a time series of plus one and minus one. And you want to know, okay, what is the time correlation property of this quantity here. And, okay, it's meaning if I observe a buy now, can I forecast if the next order is going to be a buy or a sell? Okay. And the answer, quite remarkably, is that it is extremely correlated in time. Okay, so this is the autocorrelation for one London Stock Exchange stock, AstraZeneca. So, and this is time measured in number of transactions. So essentially, this is the autocorrelation function of the sign of the order flow, of the market orders, in a log-log scale. And this is declining very, very slowly in time. In fact, this is consistent with what is called a long memory process. And essentially, in principle, I mean, above the noise level, you have some forecastability about the sign of the order, you know, 1,000 order high, many hours after. So there is very strong persistence. So buys are followed by buys, and sell are followed by sell. So there are really bursts of buying and selling. Okay. So essentially, the empirical evidence, if you want, compared to the Kyle model, is that, okay, the Kyle model, I think, is very nice and captured very well an important point. But then when you compare with the data, there is something which is not captured clearly. So the first one is that the impact is nonlinear. This is something that, at least, if you can modify the Kyle model to get nonlinear, of course, in some way. Right? But okay, the model as it is not able to do it. The impact has a permanent and temporary component, so there is a reversion of the impact after the end of the order. And the order flow is strongly autocorrelated in time. So these things are not consistent, let's say, with the Kyle model. And so what we want to do is to present a modeling framework that explains these facts as a result, again, of asymmetric information, but of a different type as compared to the Kyle model. So now, essentially, the asymmetric information is about the fact that the market maker does not know when the meta order is going to finish. Okay? So I will show you, so just to give you an anticipation if you want, there is empirical evidence that the size distribution of this meta order is extremely heterogeneous. They are very small and very big. And this creates a large uncertainty for the market maker to know, okay, when the order is going to finish, okay, when this is going to end. And this asymmetric info, this lack of information, essentially shape the market impact form. Okay, so this is the main intuition. I'm going to be quickly because I don't have much time. Okay, let me skip this part, which is not very important. So why do we have this autocorrelation function, which is very long? Okay, so what is the origin? So in principle, you might think that there are several reasons. So one reason, obvious reason, is herding. So if I buy, he's going to buy, and then he's going to buy. Maybe herding related to, I don't know, because we follow the same indicator, or because we, you know, tweet our, I don't know why, but we tweet some reason for herding, anyway. And there are some models by Blake LeBaron that show that this is possible. Another possibility, of course, goes back to Kyle. And this is mostly driven by order splitting. So order splitting create, in time, a very long time correlation. But you have to add something, in a way. Okay, we try to quantify. So we have some empirical evidence based, again, on labeled traits, or traits where we know the identity of the agents, which strongly suggest that splitting is the dominant origin of so essentially what you do, you look at which component of the autocorrelation function is due to the same guy buying now and buying in 10 minutes as compared to which component is of the autocorrelation is due to the fact that one guy is buying now, another guy is buying in 10 minutes from now. You can decompose these, and by having the suitable data, you can decompose and, you know, get the two components. So if you sum these two, you will get the full autocorrelation. The splitting part is higher than the herding part. At least in the London Stock Exchange.
Yes? Yeah.
Yeah.
And I buy hands?
Yeah.
Which component am I? I buy because I expect you to buy again because you're buying since 5 hours.
Okay.
Where am I? In which? Am I herding in your
No, I'm hurting if the correlation comes from the fact that when I buy, it's very likely that you are going to buy in the next future.
Yeah, independently of why I do so.
No, this is simply econometrical type of analysis, so it's nothing to do with, there's no motivation, this is just data if you want, okay? So this is just data, again, from the London Stock Exchange, and you have this labeled data where you can, from a modeling perspective, you can do whatever you want. I mean, you can show that under some condition of herding, so people copying each other's strategy or copying the most profitable strategies of others, you are able to reproduce this long range correlation. Then, at the end, it is an empirical fact, if you want, that you want to do. Okay? And in fact, I mean, if you reconstruct empirically from the data, you reconstruct the, remember these large orders I was showing here, like this one, okay, so this, and then you look at the distributional property, their distributional properties, so this is the cumulative probability, or inverse cumulative probability of the number of trades in one of these meta order, and this is extremely broad, so going from, of course, one trade, up to, I don't know, 10,000 or even more trades. So you have, very small meta order and very large meta order in a way, okay? And, okay, we developed some years ago a model which was able to connect, essentially, the exponent of the autocorrelation function of the order flow with the exponent of the Pareto distribution that describe the size of the meta order. So essentially, if you assume that meta orders, so you have a certain number of agents, and if you assume that meta orders, these large orders have a power law distribution, a power law tail with an exponent alpha, and for the rest they are just random in terms of sign, you can show that the autocorrelation function of the order flow is power law with an exponent which is given by this quantity. So essentially, given that in data this is equal to 0.5, very close to 0.5, this means that this quantity is equal to 1.5, which is something that you observe, okay, this is a little bit larger, also with statistically reconstructed meta order. So essentially, the key point in connecting, if you want, theory with data is that the long autocorrelation function of the order flow comes from order splitting of very large order and an extreme heterogeneity in size, a very broad distribution with your infinite variance of the size of these orders. It is also remarkable that recently, a very recent paper by some guys from Allianz Bernstein, which is a big fund in the US, they were analyzing true order, and they also find something very close to 1.5, which is exactly the prediction of this model. But these are, so while these are reconstructed large orders, these are real orders in a way, so there's a big difference between the two. Okay, so let's at least sketch the model that try to explain this this quantity here. So essentially, okay, again, I'll try to be brief. Essentially, we have, again, a model where we have portfolio manager that takes some long-term decision to buy or to sell given some information, okay? So again, we are in a symmetric information framework, and these are directional traders. So then we have, as usual, market maker that provide liquidity and set the price. So essentially, like in Kai. The directional trader order is split in pieces and trade across a certain number of time intervals, so discrete time interval, okay? And the size of the meta order, meaning the number of intervals in which this is going to be traded, is taken from a given distribution. So the one difference with Kyle, this number n is fixed, okay? So there are n auctions and this is it. So our point is that n is a random variable, so essentially the market maker does not know how long the meta order is going to continue, and then he learns that still see that the meta order is active, so you have to adjust to this. So this n is not fixed, but is determined by the size of the meta order, which is drawn by a distribution that at the end we will choose close to this. Okay? Sorry. Okay, so essentially, the sketch of the model is the following. So you start from an initial price, which you call S0, and okay, the f- the first piece of the meta order arrives, and so the price goes from here to here. Then after this, there are two possibilities. Either the meta order is finished, or the meta order continues. Okay. So if the meta order continues, the price is going to rise again. If the price, I will explain in a moment why. If the price finished, then the price is going to revert back. Okay. So I will explain in a moment why you should expect this one. If the meta order continues, you go on until the meta order is finished. In a sense. And the number of intervals in which this happens is determined by the size of the meta order, which is drawn at the beginning. Okay. So essentially, the only source of uncertainty. So like in Kyle, the market maker knows that the meta order is there, so you know when the meta order started. And the only source of uncertainty for the market maker is how long this thing is going to continue, is going to provide liquidity. Okay? And essentially, if you call PK, the probability that the meta order will continue based on the knowledge that it was active until step K, then essentially at this time interval you have two possibilities. Either the meta order continue or the meta order is finished. Okay? And okay, imposing market efficiency, so the fact that the expected value of price change in the next interval is equal to zero, you see that the probability that the meta order continues time how much is going to move if the meta order continues minus the probability that the meta order is finished times how much the price is going to move if the meta order is continued has to be equal to zero. So this is just market efficiency. So the fact that the expected value of price return is zero, okay, statistical market efficiency, okay, and you see that the form of PK depends on the distribution of the meta order size. Okay? In particular, if PN is decaying as an exponential, then this PK is constant. Okay? It's like a Poisson process, if you want. If PN is decaying slower than an exponential, then the more you have observed, the more likely is the price that the meta order is going to continue. Okay? While if this decays faster than an exponential, the opposite is true. Okay? So in a way, if you want, the more you are into the meta order, the more likely is that the meta order is going to continue. Okay? So the larger will be this PK, and therefore the smaller has to be this one compared to this one in order this to hold. Okay? Meaning when it's very likely that the meta order is going to continue, if the meta order continues, the price moves a little bit, but if the meta order finishes, the price has to move a lot in order to have an expected return equal to zero, which is something that actually you observe also in real data. Okay? Okay. So when you look, as you can expect, you can prove it, but it's pretty obvious that if you compute the profit of the market maker, which essentially is the profit of the market maker is the amount that he buys, suppose that this is a buy order, is the amount that he sells, okay, minus the value of his position after the meta order finish, so market to market, if you want. So this is the profit of the meta order, okay, because the market maker first sells and then if you want to buy back, he has to pay this quantity. You can show easily that the expected profit of the market maker averaged across all the possible size is equal to zero. So on average, the market maker does not make money if this condition holds. So this is simply the fact that efficiency implies that on average, the guy is not to make money. The extra assumption that I'm not going to justify but in the paper it's justified as a Nash equilibrium, but okay, I'm not going to enter into the detail, is that you can impose that, in fact, you can show that the profit that the market maker does on each individual meta order size is equal to zero. So it's not only that on average the market maker doesn't make money, But it doesn't make money. So market efficiency is simply telling that on average you don't make money, okay? But in principle you could do, you can make money on short meta order and lose money on large meta order, and when you do the expected value, this is equal to zero. And this is efficiency if you want. You can show, okay, and this is, really I don't have the time to show you, that you can impose this condition that the market maker in fact make zero profit on each meta order size, so lose on all the possibilities. Okay, so this is an extra condition that you can put, and once you have this one, you can close the model if you want and find the shape. It is also nice that, okay, recently there has been another paper that was justifying this condition on a different ground, and again, this paper by Ali and Bersand were testing this hypothesis empirically on real execution, and they found that this is not violated, let's say. Okay, that seems to be consistent. So now, essentially, what you have two sets of equations. So one equation is this, one set of equation, of course, is this one. One set of equation is this one, okay? And you can solve the system of equation for the price movement, okay? You have to make an assumption about the meta order size distribution. And, okay, we can do for any, of course, what we are doing is to assume a Pareto distributed meta order size distribution, okay, with an exponent alpha, as we observe in the real data. And essentially what you get, okay, you have a system of equation that you can solve. And essentially what you get is the following. So the prediction of this model is the following, is that if the size of the meta orders are Pareto distributed with an exponent alpha, the price impact is a nonlinear function of the size with an exponent which depends on alpha. Actually, the impact is this one, sorry. So it's the final price minus the initial price. And this is going to be a nonlinear function of the size of the order. Okay? In particular, we have seen from this, okay, so just to close the full model, so we have seen that the order flow is autocorrelated with an exponent 0.5. According to this model and according to some empirical evidence, this implies that meta order size distribution is as a Pareto tail with an exponent close to 1.5. Okay, and there are at least two evidence that show that this is true, empirical evidence. If you plug this into this model, you obtain that the impact is going to be k, the size to alpha minus 1. Alpha is equal to 1.5, which means that this is a square root law, which is exactly what you get, you know, from the real data, okay, which is this. Okay, not only this, but the other quantity that you can match with this model, okay, is that, okay, one is the square root law, impact law for the temporary impact, so how much you move the price for as a function of the volume, but also that the permanent impact, so that, you remember, in this tree, due to efficiency, you predict that if the meta order finishes, the price has to revert back in order that the expected return on this interval is equal to zero. So you can compute also the amount of reversion that you observe at the end of the meta order, and according to the model, essentially, what you get is that the permanent impact is 1 over alpha, which is equal to 2/3, which is, again, something that we observe in the real data. So essentially, what the model captures is that so I can go to the conclusion not on the tutorial part, if you want, is that the order flow is a long memory process. This is due, essentially, to the practice of order splitting and to the extreme heterogeneity of participants in the market. So very big order, very small order that creates all these different time scale will give you the long memory. The efficiency is restored via this asymmetric liquidity, which means it is very likely that the next order is going to be a buy. If the buy arrives, the price moves a little bit. If the next order is a sell, the price is going to move a lot. Okay? So you can restore market efficiency also in the model. You have also a matching, if you want, of exponent, which means that the exponent of the autocorrelation function can be related to the exponent of the meta order size via the model I was mentioning. And the fair pricing model predicts the square root impact and the two-third reversion as observed in the real data. So again, this paper, okay, this is good for us, of course. So this paper is, you know, essentially verifying most of the conclusion that we have seen. Okay, of course, this is just, so it's based on a large sample of institutional trades executed through Allianz Bernstein. So these are real, not statistically constructed, but real meta orders, but this essentially match very well with our prediction. So in this sense, this is promising model, I think. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you. I hope it was not too much out of focus. Maybe a bit.
Okay, it does. Thanks very much, Fabrizio. Yeah. Are there questions? Yeah.
Just a clarification, I wasn't sure whether I heard you correctly. Were you saying that the probability that the trade will extend, the meta order will extend for another period,
yeah,
was an increasing function of the number of periods yeah, of the, in the past?
Yeah.
So that feels very counterintuitive to me, I mean, in the sense that, I mean, if you're getting towards the end of the trading period, it
okay,
becomes
so
less
the,
and less.
The probability that the order continue, so it's not finished, given that I observe already K, can be related to the P, the probability distribution of the meta order size, right? And so, this is essentially the probability that the meta order is larger than K, given that it's at least K. And so it's given by this quantity here. So, okay, you can do easily the computation. For example, in the case of a Pareto size distribution, what you get out of this is that this is 1 minus alpha divided, okay, you can approximate, you can do it with the zeta function, but let's say you can approximate as 1 minus alpha divided by K. So which means that if I have observed a long run, then it's, and I don't have any other constraint, of course, then it's very likely that the order is going to continue. And of course, as I was saying, the dividing line is the exponential. For the exponential, this quantity is constant, right? I mean, so you don't learn anything by having observed K past trades. But if this is decaying faster than exponential, then it's more likely to continue.
Yeah, yeah. My worry is completely naive. I mean, it seems like a strange induction to make. If you had some view about how many big orders there were out there,
yeah,
then it would not be a very sensible thing to do. You would, on the contrary, you should think as you're getting, the more you've seen, the more you should start to think, well, you know, my luck's going to be running out soon. You know, it's everything comes to an end.
Yeah.
History is fine,
sure,
and
sure,
so on. Are we getting close to the end? Yes, we must. We're getting close to the end, so the probability should come down.
Okay, it's true. Okay. I see the point. But anyway, so this is the way in which we frame this. So if you know that you have drawn this from a distribution, then this is what we should guess.
I guess that's a bit of a normative thing, yeah, maybe, in, if you like. Are there more questions? I've seen just a fragment. He's closer, so I've seen the guy.
When geography matters.
Well, the first curiosity is just you talk about, at least when talking about empirical data,
yeah,
one meta order at a time. Should I think that they are not so frequent, or they cancel out in some way, accumulate in some way, in something with similar properties? And the other question is, I do take the picture of this. It's very interesting. But if I had to file a meta order, I would think a lot about timing and rationing, and the size of. But most importantly, I'm interested in timings. Should I think that there is some like martingale property by which, in the end, I cannot do much by simply waiting 2 seconds more and making people thinking I've stopped my meta order? And hence, it makes sense to just use the same time span every time, or it's just a simplification?
No, there are two very good questions, I would say, and clearly a limitation of the model in a way. So similar to Kyle, the assumption is that there is one meta order at a time. So what is happening in reality, it is not, it's very difficult, because then, okay, you can also go to some big fund and tell them, please give me all your orders. But then you know their orders, and then they aggregate their orders in a way in this large order. So you don't see the one of the other. So you would need, so empirically to answer this question, you would need to have more meta order at a time. I mean, so clearly it is a limitation of the model at the point, and it's just a simplifying assumption, but again, this is in line with Kyle, so it's not. You can, I'm really hand waving a little bit, considering the fact that when you have a very fat tail distribution, essentially the biggest one is going to dominate the sum. It's a little bit, it's really hand waving. I mean, it's not, I don't like too much this argument, but this is just to say. The other one is also true. I mean, from this point of view, obviously there is a huge industry about optimal execution. So the way in which you want to essentially minimize cost. If you are very sophisticated, you can also want to try to maybe give false signal to the market about the fact that you are finished, but maybe you are not finished and you want to restart, and so on and so forth. In this case, the model, which is a little bit more complicated in terms of how to justify, there is a strategic decision for the informed guy, but this strategic decision is not that much on how much to trade in each interval, and say, okay, I trade now, then I don't trade, then I trade again, and so on and so forth. But mostly about how much do I want to trade given that I observe that I have a given mispricing. Okay? There are some conditions, actually, I have a PhD student which is working more on the optimal execution, which actually finds that under some price impact model, the optimal execution is very close to what you are saying. So you trade in burst. So you trade, then you don't trade for a while, then you trade again, then you don't trade for a while, and so on. In that case, you want just to minimize price execution cost. So essentially, you want to minimize how, which is the typical problem in optimal execution, the difference between how much do you pay compared to how much you would pay in an infinite liquid market, okay? Which is an implementation shortfall. Given this is your cost function, the expected value of this is your cost function, then there are some market impact models that give you to trade in this way. In the market industry, I would say, I don't know, okay, I'm just now giving numbers around, but the vast majority of people are doing uniform execution. Yeah, which is called VWAP, volume weighted average price execution.
Okay, I'd like to thank our reluctant speaker again.
Thank you.